invitation. Receive what is yours, Jesus. Receive what is yours.
Come on, proclaim him worthy.
Worthy are you, God. Worthy is your name. You're worthy of our praise. We worship you. Here we stand in. Serving all, Jesus, evermore, we worship you. Being thrown apart,
we want to give you.
Of our sin, the life of heaven begins to you.
We're going to continue to worship the Lord, certainly through our songs, but today also through testimony. And I've got my friend Kenny with me. Kenny is a witness of God's saving grace. And Kenny, we just love to hear, how was it that the Lord got a hold of you and drew you to himself?
Well, thanks for asking me to participate today. For me, it's truly a gift to share the testimony that God gave to me. So I'll give you a little bit of background. I come from a traditional Catholic family, large family, 13 kids. I'm number 12 of 13. And so I always thought growing up that I knew Jesus Christ, but I look back now and realize that I did not have an understanding or an appreciation for truly what it meant to have a relationship with him, let alone to surrender your life to him.
Yep.
So part of the family, you know, with eight boys, we quickly got into anything that had an engine. And I think our unwritten motto was go fast and take chances. So we crashed all kinds of things and got into trouble. But there were two events in my life that were really, really serious that should have truly have ended in tragedy, but they didn't. And so I probably was bragging one time about how good I was or how lucky. And my mom, who had just this phenomenal faith, I mean, she worked so hard to share it with all of us kids. And she was there for us physically, but also spiritually. Mm-hmm. And so she pulled me aside and she said, you know, Kenny, she said, I love you, but she goes, you got to know that that wasn't luck, and sweetheart, you're not that good. So I was kind of shaken up, and she said, that was God standing beside you and protecting you. And she said, whether you like it or not, he has a calling on your life, and he'll have something for you to do someday.
Wow.
So it kind of blew me away, but I just wasn't ready for it at the time. And, you know, it just filed it away. Well, fast forward to May of 2018, and a buddy of mine and I were flying a World War II fighter plane back from California to Illinois.
Wow.
And when we were over a very remote area of Arizona, we suffered catastrophic engine failure and literally had to bail out of the airplane to make it. When I got to the ground, I was badly injured, and Ron and I had separated, so you're standing there alone and injured, and clearly it was the defining moment of my life, and I knew there was one way out, and I thought of, you know, my wife, Julie, and our two beautiful daughters, and I immediately just dropped to my knees, and I prayed, and I asked Jesus, I said, if you get me through this, then I'll surrender my life to you, and I'll freely share my testimony. Well, what happened after that is truly mind-blowing. Mm-hmm. Because he not only got me out and he got Ron out, but he answered six unbelievably specific prayer requests that I had.
Wow.
Which are impossibilities. And so that proved to me that we have such a very present God who is by our side and will absolutely respond if we just reach out and ask him to.
So you were in the most desperate of spots. I can't save myself. This is a catastrophe.
Yeah.
On every level, and yet you found the Lord present even in that.
It was palpable. I mean, it was truly, you know, I just got the tingles so many times.
Yeah.
When things that I was praying for, things that I was asking for, literally appeared right in front of me. And, you know, and don't take my word for it. I mean, if you, any of the first responders or the paramedics. Mm-hmm. Or the surgeons that put me back together.
Yeah.
They're just like, you shouldn't be standing here. And so you just knew it was way beyond anything.
Right.
that I could
so
have done.
The physical saving is a miracle, but your heart was saved, your soul was saved too, right? You mentioned your mom and how she planted seeds, and even how Psalm 23 came to you at that time, right?
Right, yeah. So, I mean, it was, I was kind of embarrassed because I didn't know a lot of scripture.
Yeah.
And all I could think of was Psalm 23. You know, I walk through the valley of the shadow of darkness, and I will not fear because you are by my side. And he was just, you just felt his presence. You know, it got me through. And without that, had my mom not planted all of those seeds, had she not cared about sharing her faith,
right,
I wouldn't be standing here today.
Unbelievable.
You know, it was, she was so powerful, and she, you know, she saved a lot of the kids.
Yeah. You had another reference that you were sharing with me, Psalm 50, verse 15. What's that say?
Yeah, so that came to me later, and, you know, it says, and come to me on the day of trouble. I will deliver you, and you shall glorify me.
That's
and
right.
This is all about the glory for God.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny side story. You know, I get a lot of people that come up to me and go, oh, Kenny, I heard about this crazy airplane story. You got to tell me, you know, all the gory parts. And I smile and I say, sure, I'll share it with you, because it's not an airplane story. Right. It's the story of my testimony to the power of prayer, and it's the story of my salvation. So yeah. I love sharing that with people.
In the day of trouble, God will deliver. He delivered you
absolutely.
Physically, more importantly, spiritually. And he's done some other things in your family too, hasn't
yeah,
he?
Yeah, yeah. What's fantastic about this, the most awesome part, is that my wife Julie had a front row seat.
Yes.
Seeing the power of God move in my life and what he did for me, what he did for our family. And she surrendered her life to Christ as well.
Unbelievable.
So, yes, absolutely fabulous.
God reviving your heart and drawing you to himself and your wife as well. Praise God.
Yep.
Well, we're going to continue to worship, but our God is worthy to be praised. Thanks, Kenny.
All right, Dave. Yeah.
Save all things. Such an awesome God, you are so great.
Great are you,
Father, that's what we're declaring here. We stand in this place to declare to you that you are great and you're greatly to be praised. You are so awesome, God. You're the only one who deserves this. The only one worthy of this is you, because you're great. And when your presence is here, we know that the mountains tremble. They tremble before you, for you can just speak the word and that mountain will move. Things we think are impossible, and they're impossible for us, but they're not impossible for you, God. And that's why we bring to you these songs. We stand in awe of who you are, God. We're your people. We're your children. And all this praise belongs to you. God, I ask that you would be with me as I open your word, that you would be the one guiding me. God, that we would hear from you as we hear from your word. Have your way here, God. We invite you to do whatever you want to do here. You're welcome here. And it's in the name of Jesus that I pray. And if you agree with that prayer, say amen. 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 Man, it is so good to get to worship Jesus Christ together this weekend. Now, I'm going to be honest with you. As I was preparing to share this passage this week, as I was preparing, it was a bit difficult. It was a pretty difficult week. And not only has it been a long week filled with many distractions, but I've just been feeling the weight of what I'm about to preach to you. And I'll be honest, I think I've been feeling spiritual attack because of what I'm about to preach. Because I'm about to preach the core of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I'm preaching something that Satan does not want preached anywhere. He doesn't want this preached under any circumstance, in any place. Because in it, there's a message. And if you receive this message, you will never be the same. And the power isn't in what I'm going to say. The power is in what God has said. So as we dive into Mark chapter 15, you will find this good news. What is the gospel of Jesus Christ? We're now approaching the final section of the book of Mark, and that is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. We're reaching the culmination of the entire book. Man, what a year it's been to go through just Jesus studying the book of Mark, and we're reaching the culmination. Because if you remember at the beginning of the book, Mark started by saying this in chapter 1, verse 1. He said, "The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God." The Son of God. And for the rest of the book, no other person in the book of Mark is going to declare that Jesus was the Son of God up until this passage in Mark chapter 15, where there will be a man who says that truly this was the Son of God. And that's the message today. Truly the Son of God. Jesus was truly the Son of God. The Son of God meaning deity. That's what I mean when I say the Son of God. That means he's the second person in the Trinity. And last week we ended with Pilate delivering Jesus over to be crucified, and then he sends him with those Roman soldiers who are going to fulfill that command from Pilate. They're going to execute Jesus. And maybe you're joining us for the first time this weekend. Hey, if that's you, someone just sent you a link and now you're watching it, can I just say I'm so glad that you're here. And you might think today's just a normal day. But today doesn't have to be normal, because if you listen to what I'm about to say and you receive the truth from the Bible, today could be the day that God changes your life forever. And here, we're going to study exactly what Christianity is all about. If you've ever wondered that, if you've ever wondered, hey, what's up with Christianity? What do they believe? What's this all about? Well, that's exactly what we're talking about today. First, I'm going to explain what it is that's happening to Jesus, and then I'm going to explain why this is such an important event. So as we dive into Mark chapter 15, what do we see? We're going to see three things. The first thing we see is Jesus mocked. That's our first point, Jesus mocked. So let's dive in, Mark 15, starting in verse 16. It says this, "And the soldiers led him away inside the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole battalion. And they clothed him in a purple cloak, and twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on him, and they began to salute him, 'Hail, King of the Jews!' And they were striking his head with a reed and spitting on him and kneeling down in homage to him. And when they had mocked him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him, and they led him out to crucify him." So they leave the governor's headquarters, and a couple weeks ago I gave you this map, so just as a reminder, there's the temple, there's the Garden of Gethsemane, that's where they arrest Jesus, and then I think most likely the governor's headquarters refers to the Antonia fortress that is near the temple, and they lead him from that fortress with a battalion, and a battalion would have been a Roman cohort, so this is about 600 soldiers. It's not really wartime, so I don't know if they send all 600, but for sure they send a lot of them, clearly. And what they do is this. They put a purple cloak on Jesus because what they're doing is they're dressing him up in order to make fun of him. That's what's happening. And in the book of Mark, he calls that cloak a purple cloak, and Matthew calls it a scarlet cloak. So as I was studying this week, I found out that you can describe that color with both those words, which kind of blew my mind, because honestly, I grew up, and up until this week, I still believed that the color purple is the color violet. I didn't know that those were different things. And but here, let me just show it to you this way. Here's the CIE chromaticity diagram. I'm getting very scientific today. So there's a color spectrum. Now notice, purple actually counts as anything in between blue and red. So the color violet leans more towards blue, and the color scarlet for sure leans more towards red. It's a deep red. And so that's why you can still say it's a purple cloak, because it's within the category of what is universally accepted as the color purple. Then they twist together a crown of thorns. And what they're doing is they're making a crown to mock him, so he has his robe, but then they're going to make a crown kind of like what an emperor in that time would have had, like Tiberius. He had a crown, but notice that it's actually more like a wreath. That's what would have been common in that day. So they're twisting together a crown of thorns. Most likely, they made this from the buckthorn plant. That's likely because that plant grows everywhere in the land of Israel. Now notice, these aren't some like rose stem thorn, if you've ever seen one of those. Look at these things. They are 1 to 2 inches long, each one of those thorns. And, you know, growing up, we didn't have yards, really. Growing up in Mexico, there's no grass in front or behind your house. All there is concrete. And we had a patio, though. And in this patio, it was kind of in the middle of the house. And then all around it was just concrete walls, 2 stories high. And so you could see the sky, but there was no grass around. But that's where we would play, in that patio. And I remember that on one of the walls of that patio was my parents' bedroom. And so they would open the window kind of at a 45-degree angle, and it was just a metal window. And as kids out there, we'd be playing, and then we'd have a ball or a toy or whatever, and we'd go under the window. And sure enough, as we would come up, we would hit our head on the corner of that window, and we'd have a cut. And actually, to this day, I don't know if you're going to be able to see it, but I still have a scar somewhere back there from doing that very thing. And here's the thing I can tell you about head injuries. There is not a small amount of blood that comes out. There's a large amount of blood. And if you've ever cut your forehead, you might be like, you didn't even notice it happened, and then suddenly blood's gushing down your face. And that's just with one cut. Now think about what they're doing to Jesus. They've twisted this crown of thorns together, and they place it on his head, and then they push it down into his scalp. Not a small amount of blood. This is why those Renaissance paintings, if you've ever seen them, of the crucifixion of Jesus, they really don't help you. They don't help you really sense what's happening here. And they say, "Hail, King of the Jews," which is clearly an expression that the readers of, of the book of Mark would have understood that he's referencing hailing Caesar, as they would have said in that time, hail Caesar. But the Jews don't have a king at this time, so it's nothing real. It's just making fun of Jesus. Now, the irony of all this is that they're mocking him as a king when, in fact, he is the king. Jesus is coming back one day, and he will be called King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And though here in Mark, he's still king, he's chosen to be the suffering king. And they strike his head with a reed. A reed would just be like a stick. And they hit his head that already had the crown of thorns on it. So do you see the extreme violence that's happening here? It's not just the crown of thorns. They're grabbing a stick and they're striking his head with it. And I'm not going to put a picture up here to gross you out. That's not what I'm trying to do. I'm not trying to make you uncomfortable. But I want you to sense to what lengths Jesus is the suffering king. And they spit on him and keep the ridicule going as they kneel down in homage to him. What did Jesus do to deserve this? I mean, he had just spent 3 years going out through the whole area, teaching about the kingdom of God, performing miracles for the benefit of others. Why would they treat someone like him like this? It's because he's the suffering king. So here's the thing, Jesus is king. But my question is, do you treat him as king? Maybe you say to me, look, I love singing worship songs and I put my hands in the air and I love sermons. I listen to them all week. I love listening to sermons. But then as you're listening to God's word, when it starts confronting your heart and your sin, you kind of brush it off. You say, well, I'm in up until I'm not. Now that God's word's saying I have to change the way I'm behaving, I'm not really in on that. Well, if that's you, and you aren't obeying the king's commandments, then you're mocking him. You're pretending like he isn't king. And this mocking continues in verse 21. It says this, and they compelled a passerby, Simon of Cyrene, who was coming in from the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to carry his cross. And they brought him to the place called Golgotha, which means place of a skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his garments among them, casting lots for them to decide what each should take. So when it says that they compelled a passerby, that's just like a really nice way of saying that they forced Simon to do this. And Simon is coming into the city when they're leading Jesus out of the city. They're leading him out of the city because that's where they're going to execute him. And Mark mentions Simon's sons, which are Alexander and Rufus. He mentions that because probably the readers of the book of Mark are going to recognize those names somehow for some reason. And they force Simon to help Jesus because they've already tortured Jesus so much that he's too weak to be able to carry his cross. And not the entire cross, because historically, the Roman tradition was to have a person carry the cross piece of a cross that was known as the patibulum. This is the horizontal piece of a cross, and normally it would weigh over 100 pounds. And they take him to a place outside the city called the place of a skull. It's called that probably for one of these three reasons. One, it looked like a skull. Maybe you looked at the hill where they're going to do this and you're like, yeah, I can kind of see that. That looks like a skull. Second reason might be that they found skulls there because it was a cemetery previously. Or the third reason could be simply because this is where they went to execute people. So they call it the place of a skull. They're going to offer Jesus wine two times, linking what they're doing to Jesus to Psalm 69, verse 21, which says this, they gave me poison for food, and for my thirst they gave me sour wine. And the first occasion is here in verse 23. It's wine mixed with myrrh, which in the Greek, it's actually a verb form, so you could say what they gave him was myrrhed wine, because it's a verb. And Matthew uses a different word to describe the taste of this wine, but Mark uses this word to describe the fact that the ingredient of myrrh was in it. And if you do a word study on this topic, you'll find that this word was used to describe a poisoned drink or a poisoned water in other places in the scripture. So what's most likely happening here is that the soldiers are trying to poison Jesus to speed up the process of his death, because those soldiers had to stay with him until the completion of the execution, and they probably don't want to be there for days, so they're just trying to speed it up. But Jesus does not take that myrrhed wine, because Jesus doesn't look for or isn't looking for an easy way out. He's a suffering king. He's choosing to undergo the full length of time it would take to bear the sins of the world. And they crucify him and divide his garments, which is a fulfillment of Psalm 22, verses 16 through 18. And they leave him either only with an undergarment or with nothing at all. They're shaming him. Jesus is being mocked. We see Jesus mocked, and then we see this. We see Jesus crucified. Jumping back in at verse 25, it says this, "And it was the third hour when they crucified him. And the inscription of the charge against him read, 'The King of the Jews.' And with him they crucified two robbers, one on his right and one on his left." All right, let's talk about time. Let's talk about these hours that are mentioned, because John says that Jesus was crucified about the sixth hour, so that would be around noon. And Mark says that Jesus was crucified at the third hour. So which one is it? Well, to explain that to you, you need to understand that we live in times of extreme specificity when it comes to time. We just do. So we wear devices and watches and smartphones that all talk to satellites, and they log every little action that we do with our phones and tell you exactly when you did that. You can know exactly what minute you sent that text. You can know exactly what minute you sent out that tweet, for those of you who still have Twitter accounts. You can know that, but this is a relatively modern experience. I mean, let's just rewind back to the 90s, the good old 90s. I remember having a phone that was just a landline for our house, and I used to have to memorize my friends' phone numbers to be able to call them, and I'd pick it up. It was just buttons, just a wire, and there was no log of which of who I was calling. If I wanted a phone log, I would probably had to call the company, and they would have printed out some sort of phone log with one of those printers with the perforated edges. You know what I'm talking about? And so I'd call my friend. Now, let's say one day I call him after breakfast and before lunch. We talk for a bit. Then if you would have asked me the very next day after I made that phone call, "Hey, what time did you call your friend?" I would have been like, I don't know, sometime like around 10. And I would have had to estimate, because I wasn't fully aware of exactly what was going on, and there was no way to track it. And that's in a world where there are clocks. There were clocks around. I just had to look at one. That's all I needed to do to know when I called my friend. Now imagine a world without clocks. No clocks at all, so you had to estimate time. And here in the Jewish culture, they would do this in three-hour increments. So normally, they'd say the hour, and that could refer to the block of 3 hours of the day that they were talking about. So when Mark says the third hour, it was very common that that could have meant 9 a.m. It could have also meant 10 a.m. It could have also even meant 11 a.m. What's most likely is that Jesus was crucified sometime between 9 a.m. and noon. And Mark is rounding down, and John is rounding up. Additionally, in our Western extreme specificity minds, we always think of the crucifixion as like literally the moment where they drive the nails through his hands, and when the cross goes up, in our minds, we might think that's when he's crucified. But if you just study the passage, notice, what did Pilate send Jesus to be? He said, "Go crucify him." So he delivers him to be crucified, and then all this other stuff happens. So it's very possible that Mark is referring to when the crucifixion process started. Either way, this isn't a contradiction. And if you take the time to understand how it was perceived, how time was perceived in this culture, how it was measured, it all makes perfect sense. So they crucify him, and they put a sign either around his neck or above him on the cross that held the charges that were against him. And the charge they have against him is that he's the king of the Jews. Other people would have had a sign that said murderer or guilty of high treason. But his says that he's the king of the Jews. Again, the irony is that they're crucifying him for being the king of the Jews, but they don't even believe that he's the king of the Jews. And they place him in between two real robbers. And you remember a couple weeks ago I talked about how that word robbers really could be better translated as the word terrorists. These guys might have even been friends with Barabbas. And Rome typically did not crucify just thieves or shoplifters. So these guys had a serious rap sheet. Let's continue in verse 29. It says this, "And those who passed by derided him, wagging their heads and saying, 'Aha, you who would destroy the temple and rebuild it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross.' So also the chief priests with the scribes mocked him to one another, saying, 'He saved others. He cannot save himself. Let the Christ, the King of Israel, come down now from the cross that we may see and believe.' Those who were crucified with him also reviled him." Here they wag their heads. That just means that they're mocking him. They're making faces at him to mock him. And again, they bring up this phony accusation that he was going to destroy the temple, and they tell him to save himself. But notice what they said. They said he can save others. What they're referring to is the physical saving, that he had performed miracles to heal people, but he can't save himself. He can't heal his way out of this one. Man, just like Judas, they knew Jesus had power, but they didn't get just how much power Jesus had. See, God is powerful. And he is powerful enough to change anything that's going on in your life. But notice here, Jesus doesn't use his power. He chooses not to use his power because he's fulfilling his purpose. Sometimes God's inaction is the way he's fulfilling his purpose in your life. Oh, I'm preaching to someone now. Sometimes God's inaction is the way he's fulfilling his purpose in your life. So no matter what you've been praying for, if you've been praying for God to deliver you from that painful situation that you're in, you have to believe that there's still a reason for it. And you have to keep praying that God would deliver you from it. But also pray that God would open your eyes to see all the opportunities that he has right in front of you right now without his deliverance. Notice that in verse 32, the two men crucified next to Jesus also revile him. And you might remember that Luke tells us about how one of these men will eventually change his perspective about Jesus. But at least here at the beginning, they're both reviling Jesus. And Mark keeps using different words to describe how people spoke to Jesus to emphasize just how obscene they're being towards him. He uses the word that they mocked him and that they reviled him and that they derided him. All these things Mark is showing us, that I don't think any words were off limits for these people. We see Jesus mocked, we see Jesus crucified, and then finally this, we see Jesus dying. Verse 33. "And when the sixth hour had come, there was darkness over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried with a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you forsaken me?'" So around noon, we see that darkness covers the whole earth for hours because it's the sixth hour and then all the way to the ninth hour. Clearly, this is going to happen for hours. And this was not just an eclipse, by the way. I know that because this happened the week of Passover, remember? And at the week of Passover, it's celebrated at full moon. So we know that the moon and the sun are in opposite ends of the sky at this time. What's happening here is a supernatural darkening of the sun. It was a sign of God's judgment. Because many times in Scripture, darkness and judgment would go together. So Jesus says, my God, why have you forsaken me? So what does that mean? What does it mean that Jesus was forsaken? Well, let's start here. It does not mean that the Trinity was broken at any point. It does not mean that. Let me be clear. Jesus was, is, and always will be the Son of God, the second person in the Trinity. And there was never a moment where that was broken. So then what does this forsaking mean? Well, I've heard authors word it certain ways. I've heard songwriters also word it different ways. I'll share with you what I think is the easiest way of understanding it is to see what Jesus said, because he's quoting Psalm 22 when he says this line, my God, why have you forsaken me? And by quoting Psalm 22, he's not only quoting that line, but he's also affirming that the other three things that line up with his crucifixion from Psalm 22, he's saying, yes, that's what's happening here. What's happened and what was said thousands of years before in Psalm 22. And Psalm 22:1, that verse says, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from saving me from my words, from the words of my groaning? See, Jesus is feeling the fact that God the Father is not going to save him from this. He's not going to deliver him from this suffering. He's not asking a question to hear the answer. He's asking this question to express his misery. And we still talk like that today. I've been to many funerals, and I've sat with friends or family members, and we're grieving the loss of someone. And I've been in the funeral home, and we're just sitting in that quiet. And I'm next to my friend or a family member, and I say, how could this hurt so much, though? How could I feel so much pain? See, I'm not asking that to hear the answer. I'm asking that to express my misery. And that's what Jesus is doing here. He's expressing his misery by saying, my God, why have you forsaken me? Then it continues in verse 35. And some of the bystanders hearing it, what he had just said, they said, behold, he is calling Elijah. And some ran and filled a sponge with sour wine, put it on a reed, and gave it to him to drink, saying, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down. And Jesus uttered a loud cry and breathed his last. They mishear what Jesus said in that line, and I don't know if they mishear on purpose or by accident, but they hear him say Eloi, and they think it's Eli or Elijah, and then they mock him for that, saying, let's see if this guy he's calling on would actually show up and help him and take him down from the cross. Then they offer him wine for the second time, and this time it's wine that is sour, most likely mixed with vinegar. And in the Gospel of John, we know that Jesus at least took one sip of that sour wine. Remember Psalm 69 that I just mentioned? It says, they gave me poison for food, and for my thirst, they gave me sour wine. Then Jesus cries out aloud, and neither Mark nor Matthew tell us what he said, but then if you go to Luke, you see that Jesus said, into your hands I commit my spirit. And John adds that he also said, it is finished, before he dies. He dies. Jesus dies. So what exactly happened when Jesus died? Well, Let me give you two things that did not happen, and then I'll give you one thing that did happen. First, when Jesus died, Jesus did not go to hell. There is a belief in the history of the church that he went to hell, and a lot of that comes from Ephesians chapter 4, verse 9, which says he descended into the lower parts of the earth. And so people believe that the lower parts of the earth would be hell, and so it's saying that Jesus went to hell. But that's just not a proper understanding of the grammar of that verse, because it's saying he descended into the lower parts of the earth, which is the earth. Let me explain it to you this way. If you were to ask me, hey, Eddie, where do you live? I would say, I live in the city of Elgin. That's how I would answer that question. But when I say the city of Elgin, that means the city that is Elgin. Okay, so he descended into the lower parts of the earth. The lower parts of the earth, meaning he descended into the lower parts, which are the earth, or which is the earth. He left the high places, the heavenly places, and descended to the earth. That's what that verse means. And additionally, if we study the crucifixion in the book of Luke, he tells one of the men, Jesus tells one of the men that's crucified next to him, that he's going to see him that very day in paradise. And paradise is not hell. So clearly that's not where Jesus is going. And also he says he commits his spirit into the hands of the Father, meaning that he's going to be received by the hands of the Father after he dies. So Jesus did not go to hell. Second thing that did not happen is Jesus did not become a sinner. So when God says in 2 Corinthians 5:21, he says, "For our sake, he made him, the Father made the Son, to be sin who knew no sin." That does not mean that Jesus became a sinner. Okay, because Jesus is God and God cannot sin. What that verse means is that Jesus became our sin offering. He's the sin offering for us. You remember in the Old Testament, they would have used that spotless lamb as a sacrifice. Well, that spotless lamb didn't become impure at the end of the sacrifice. It remains pure all the way through the sacrifice as a spotless lamb. And Jesus is the same. He remains pure all the way as our sin offering as the Lamb of God. He doesn't become a sinner, and he doesn't go to hell, but here's what did happen when Jesus died. Jesus completed the payment for sin on the cross. That's why he says, "It is finished." What is finished? The payment is finished, and he did that on the cross. Jesus dies once for all. Then see what happens next in verse 38. It says, "And the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood facing him saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, 'Truly this man was the Son of God.'" After Jesus dies, in one moment, God tears this 82-foot tall curtain from top to bottom, and he tears it in two. The tearing of the curtain is God showing the world that humankind now has free access to God through the blood of Jesus. And if you want to have a relationship with God, look, you don't need anyone else to grant you access to God except for Jesus Christ. You don't have to ask permission from any other person. Then after the curtain is torn, that's where we see this moment where the penny drops and we realize that Jesus really was who he said he was. He truly was the Son of God. This wasn't just another Roman execution. This was Jesus being the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. And then the last two verses, verses 40 and 41, it says this: "There were also women looking on from a distance, among whom were Mary Magdalene and Mary, the mother of James the younger and of Joseph, and Salome. When he was in Galilee, they followed him and ministered to him. And there were also many other women who came up with him to Jerusalem." These verses show the faithfulness of these women as they were followers of Jesus. But it also shows us that Jesus didn't come to save a specific kind of person. And this time, women weren't viewed to have even close to the same rights as men. But all throughout Jesus' ministry, he goes out of his way to show that both women and men are welcome in the kingdom of God. They're equal in value. They're equally created in the image of God. And look, I don't have time to preach a whole sermon on this today, though someday I'd love to do that. But I just have to point out how significant it is that this is mentioned in the crucifixion of Jesus. Everyone is welcome if you believe that Jesus was truly the Son of God. I want you to receive this life-changing truth, but you have to believe this truth in order to receive it. The gospel is good news. And here's the good news. I'm going to say it in one sentence for you, as best as I can. The good news is this: Jesus died on the cross in your place so that you could be saved from your sin. Jesus died on the cross in your place so that you could be saved from your sin. That's the truth of the gospel. That's what the good news is. And it's hard to hear that good news sometimes because all you're getting told is just a bunch of lies in the world about the gospel, things that are completely false. So let me tell you three lies about the gospel as I close. First lie: all religions basically talk about the same thing. You know, in the end, we're all going to end up in some sort of pseudo heaven with some sort of pseudo God, where we're all together, and it didn't really matter what you believed on earth. I mean, it's all the same stuff. Like, we're just going to live together, and it's fine that you believe what you believe and I believe what I believe. Well, let's listen to God's word. Acts chapter 4, verse 12, it says this: "And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no other name under heaven given to men by which we must be saved." Look, there's no wiggle room here. The good news is that there is a way. There is someone who can save, and it's Jesus Christ alone. Second lie about the gospel: God will grade on a curve, right? You think, well, I'm not that bad of a person. Like, I've never murdered anyone, or I've lived with my wife for 15 years. I'm a pretty good person. God's got a grade on a curve. Like, how could he send me to hell when there's all those worse people out there? Well, let's let God's word answer that. James chapter 2, verse 10 says this: "For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for it all." What that means is, look, here's the standard. All that God has said, all of God's commands. And if you can't keep all of it, then you're guilty. You're guilty. But don't worry, you're in good company. I'm guilty too. There's not a person who's ever lived, except for Jesus Christ, that has kept the law, that's kept all the rules that God has given to us. God's not going to grade on a curve, but he's given you good news to that problem. Line number three: your sin is not a big deal. Some people struggle to really understand how severe it is that they've sinned against a holy God. And you think, well, you know, I mean, God's going to judge me just because I had a thought in my heart? It's because God is holy. He is perfect in every way. And we chose to sin against him. He's the one who created everything. And he puts us in a perfect garden in relationship with him. And our response is sin? That is greatly offensive, because God is great, and he's the one who your sin offends. The Bible says in Romans chapter 6, "For the wages of sin is death." Sin is a big deal. and the consequence of sin is death. So the lies are that we're basically all talking about the same thing, or that God will grade on a curve, or your sin's not that big a deal. But the truth is that Jesus died on the cross in your place so that you could be saved from your sin. That's really, really good news. So then you might ask me, well, then what do I need to do? How can I be saved? Well, let me break it down for you really simply. First, you need to believe. You have to believe. You have to believe that the things that I just taught you from God's word really did happen. That Jesus truly was the Son of God who died on that cross. You need to believe, and then you need to confess. To confess just means that you need to say it. Okay, so I'm going to give you a chance to say this to God. You believe, you confess, but then also this, you need to repent. To repent means to change your mind. What I need you to understand is if you make this decision today to receive the good news of the gospel, you're going to spend the rest of your life following after Jesus and pressing into him and learning more about him and growing in love towards him and finding out more and more that he is king. He's king, so whatever he commands, I want to do because he saved me. I'm so thankful for that. I want to obey. And he's Lord, which means he's in charge. When God says it, game over. I don't argue with God. And he's my Savior. He saves me from what I have done. But here's the awesome thing. If you receive the gospel today, God saves you from everything you would have become. And he forgives you for those sins as well. So you repent because God has made you his own, and now you're just going to start walking that out. You won't be perfect, and you won't be able to do it in your own strength. But listen, God will provide what you need in order for you to follow him. So you need to believe, confess, and repent. Because so many people, they look out there at Christians, and they think Christians are just such nice people. They do such nice things. Well, you need to understand that those people aren't Christian because they do good things. They do good things because they're Christian. Because they understand the good news that Jesus died on the cross in their place so that they could be saved from their sin. So if that's you today, hey, wherever you're listening from, if you're with people or by yourself, and you're ready right now, you're ready to believe the truth about this good news. You're ready to confess it. You're ready to repent. Well, then just say this prayer back to God. Just repeat after me right there in your heart. Say, God, I believe that Jesus died on that cross in my place. And I'm turning away from my sin. And I want to follow you from here forward. I believe that you are my king, that you are my Lord, and that you are my Savior. In the name of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, if you pray that prayer, if you believe, if you confess, and you repent, you are now a child of God. And today is no ordinary day. Welcome to the family of God. And because we're family, we don't want to just leave you on your own. So I want to invite you, if you made this decision today, just text the word follow. So grab your phone, text the word follow to 797979. This isn't an infomercial. We're not going to sell you anything. Here's why we're doing this. We want to reach out to you. We want to send you a free gift to help you understand, okay, what do I do now? I made this decision. Now what am I supposed to do? So please just text the word follow to 797979. And we'll reach out to you to get you this free gift. Text that word if you made the decision. But if you didn't pray with me, but you want to make that decision, just text that word anyways. It's not too late. Listen to me. It's not too late. You can still make this decision today. Text in at any point. Text that word follow to 797979. Even now, as we continue in worship.
Gospel changes everything. The point in history, and even now it's changing me from who I was. The story of my Savior calls me to the wonder of the cross. The gospel changes everything. It is changing me. You saved my soul by your blood, and I'm undone by your great love. You made a way so changes everything. There is no greater mystery that God would come to rescue me from who I was. Oh, the kindness of my Savior calls me to the wonders of His love. Jesus changes everything, and He is changing me. You saved my soul by your blood, and I'm undone by your great love.
Today's a good day. It's a good day because in faith, I believe someone went from darkness to light. And we want to celebrate with you. Please tell everyone you know about this decision and make sure you text in that word follow to 797979, because we want to hear from you so that we can reach out to you, get you that free gift, and come alongside of you as you follow Jesus like we're following Jesus. Hey, I'm so glad you were able to join us. As you head into this week, we want you to know that you are loved.